पुराने जमाने के
टीचिंग के तरीकों से
हमको क्यों पढ़ाते हैं,
इट्स सो बोरिंग।
अब वेदांत देगा प्रॉब्लम से छुटकारा।
हाय किड्स,
हेलो टीचर। आएगा तो मजा आएगा तो समझ आएगा।
बेस्ट टीचर्स पढ़ाए तो सिंपल लगे एवरीथिंग।
लीडर बोर्ड्स एंड क्विज़ेस से
अमेजिंग।
समझ आएगा तो
Vedantu, learn live online. To attend a free live class, download the app now.
Hello everyone, welcome back. I hope all of you are doing great and a very good evening. So guys, today as part of the Killer 5 series, we will be continuing with the chapter Set, Relation and Function. So for those who are coming here for the first time, my name is Shimon Joseph and I am a math master teacher here at Vedantu. So guys, Killer 5 is a effort from Vedantu to expose all of you students to some difficult questions which you might encounter in JEE Mains. Okay, so we will be discussing some really awesome questions with unique approaches as part of this series. So the schedule for this is given over here. You guys can have a look and make a note of it. So we started off with trigonometry yesterday. Today I'll be discussing set, relation and function, and the list goes on in this fashion. So the classes will be on Saturdays and Sundays at 9 p.m. So mark your calendars and make the best use of it, guys. Okay, so let us get started. Let's dive right into the first question of today's session. The first question is given on your screen. So this question was asked in JEE Mains 2018 and it is from the chapter set. The reason I chose this question is because it has multiple concepts intertwined in a single question. Let's see what those multiple concepts are and you guys are going to solve along with me. And if you guys know the answer, do comment it down or type it down in the chat box. Perfect. Okay, so let us get started. So we have two sets A and B and they are defined as such. And I want to figure out whether A is a subset of B or B is a subset of A, or whether A and B have some intersection. So these are the things which I have to figure out. Once I do that, my job is over. Clear? Perfect, guys. So A is a set in such a way that it contains all ordered pairs A comma B belonging to R cross R. So guys, before we get into the question, what is an ordered pair A comma B when it belongs to R cross R? Can I say it can represent any point in the Cartesian plane? Because Cartesian plane contains x comma y, where x is abscissa and y is the ordinate, and x comma y belong to real numbers. That is exactly what we have here. So A comma B is any point in the Cartesian plane. But wait a minute, it is not just any point. If it has to be in set A, then it has to satisfy this relation. Isn't that correct? So I have to make sure A satisfies this inequality and B satisfies this inequality. So that portion is going to be my set A. So that is the important point here. So set A is a region in the Cartesian plane. That if you guys crack it, you're almost done with the question. Similarly, set B also will be a region, but let me go to that a bit later. Let's solve A first. So I will try to understand what is my set A and try to completely nail it down. Okay, so let us get started. What do I have? I have mod of A minus 5 is less than 1. And I also have mod of B minus 5 less than 1. So let's try to understand this even better. How do I open this mod? I know that if mod of A minus 5 is less than 1, then A minus 5 should be between minus 1 to 1. That's how you open a mod inequality. I'm sure you guys are aware of it. If not, please do revise your basic mathematics, guys. Okay. So your A will lie between what? Your A will lie between 4 to 6. Your A will lie between 4 to 6. And similarly, your B also will lie in the same interval because it is almost the same inequality. Okay. So this is the region that determines my set A. So my A will be 4 to 6 and my B will be 4 to 6. That region in the Cartesian plane will be my set A. Is that fine, guys? So let me keep that aside. I'm going to erase everything and I'm going to store only these two information because that is what matters to me. I know that A and B both lie between 4 and 6. So that is the only piece of information which I will hold with myself. Others, I'm going to erase and move on to solving the next part. Let's try to solve the next part, which is set B. I'm going to come to that portion now. Okay. So what do I have in set B? Can I bring this 36 down and write it as A minus 6 the whole square by 9 plus B minus 5 the whole square by 4 is less than or equal to 1. And guys, don't you think this looks like a ellipse equation? Something like x square by a square plus y square by b square is equal to 1. Something similar to that. So therefore, this shape will be that of an ellipse. And all the portion or all the region within the ellipse. Why within the ellipse? Because less than equal to 1 is given. So on the ellipse and within the ellipse is the region B. But how do I draw this ellipse? It's not a standard one, right? It is a shifted one. The center is not at origin. Rather, the center is at 6, 5. I hope you guys got that. Now, the major axis is this one, right? Because this is dominating. So, A is equal to 3. So, 2A will be the length of major axis, which is 6. And we know that 2B will be equal to 4 because B is equal to 2. Done. So I've got all the information set down for me. I just need to solve my question, get the answer and be done with it. So let me write down all this information here. So my length of major axis is 6, length of minor axis is 4, center of the ellipse is 6, 5. I hope that is all. Okay. So let me erase this information. Now I'm going to go back to Cartesian plane. So Cartesian plane means what? Your coordinate axis. So let me draw the coordinate axis. Now, 6, 5 is my center of the ellipse. And this particular region is my set A. So I'll draw set A first because it's very simple to draw that. This is 4. Let's say this is 6. And similarly, this is 4. Let's say this is your 6. Okay. So you will have a square shape over here. So this is your set A. Are you all able to follow that? Because A lies between 4 to 6. What is A? A is your x coordinate sort of. Isn't that correct? And B is your y coordinate sort of. So B lies between 4 to 6. So that region, when I have intersection, they'll form a square. And all points inside the square will satisfy my... All points inside the square will satisfy my set A. That is how you understand it. Why all points? Sir, why not only integer points, sir? Because they have told A and B belonging to R cross R. So all real numbers inside should satisfy my set A. Getting it, guys? Now, what is the center of my ellipse? The center of my ellipse is 6, 5. So 6 is there. This is 6, 4. This is 6, 6. So the midpoint of this will be the center of my ellipse, which is 6, 5. Isn't that correct? And I know that the length of major axis is 6. So this extension will be 3 units and this extension will be 3 units. Isn't that correct? So this point will be what? This point will be 3, 5 and this point will be 9, 5. That will be the end points of my vertex of the ellipse. Okay. And then again from 6, 5 on top I'll move 2 units and on bottom I'll move 2 units. So you'll have 6, 3 and you'll have 6, 7 as the end points of minor axis. So that's it. Draw your ellipse. So everything inside this will be my set B. Everything inside this will be my set B. I hope you guys got it. So guys, can you see that my set A completely lies inside set B? That's it. So I can say my set A is a subset of set B. So answer is option C. I hope you guys got it. Now one doubt which you might ask me is, sir, this is fine, sir. The top is above and here also it's above. I get it. But how do you know these edges are inside? Guys, it's very easy to check it. Because what are the coordinates of the edges? This edge coordinate is 4, 4. And the edge coordinate over here is 4, 6. Just substitute in the ellipse equation and see if it is satisfying. If I substitute 4,4 and 4,6 and if it satisfies, then it is proved, guys. It's done. That means it's inside the ellipse. Because for a point lying inside the ellipse, we know that the condition is S1 less than 0. Don't you all remember that? We studied that in coordinate geometry. That is also being applied. Such a good question which has lot of interesting concepts. And that is why we discussed it here today. A mix of coordinate geometry and set. Okay? I hope all of you understood it. So the answer is A is a subset of B because A lies completely inside B. Got it? So if you have any doubts or comments, please do let me know in the chat or you can leave a comment after the video is done. Okay? I will try to help you guys out. With that, let's move forward to the next question, guys. I hope all of you are clear. And if you want to go over it slowly, I have attached the solution as well so that you guys can check it out later on. The session PDF will be available in the description after the session is over. Okay, let us get started. So guys, the second question for all of you is given on your screen over here. So let us have a look at it. So this question was asked in the year 2011 JEE Mains and it is from the chapter relation. And I'm sure most of you have lost touch with this chapter or you haven't revised it that frequently. So let's try to understand how to solve this question. What is an equivalence relation and what are the areas that you have to be careful while solving such questions? Okay, so let me start solving. Please do try it out along with me, guys. And if you have any doubts or questions, feel free to ask. Okay, so now you have R as the set of all real numbers. Okay, now they are giving you two statements and you have to figure out whether they are true or not. Let's try to do that. Statement one says that X, Y will belong to R cross R. That is the set of real numbers cross set of real numbers. Okay, so it's an ordered pair in the Cartesian plane, just like what we saw earlier. If it is going to be an integer, if what is going to be an integer? Y minus X. Then it will belong to my relation. Is it an equivalence relation or not? I have to find it out. So how do you check for equivalence relation? You have to first check for reflexive and then you have to check for symmetric and then you have to check for transitive. Okay, so let's try to do that. So guys, to check for reflexive, you have to take identical elements. So that means I have to check for X, X. So when I take X, X for all X belonging to real numbers, that means what? Any real number X you take, X, X, if I choose, will it lie inside my relation? If it does, then it is reflexive. Okay. So I am choosing X, X such that X belongs to real numbers. And do you all agree that X minus X is always 0? So can I say X minus X is always an integer? Therefore, X, X will always belong to my relation. Okay. X, X will always belong to relation. Because if you take any X belonging to R, X, X will always satisfy the difference being an integer. Therefore, it is reflexive. So one down, two more to go. What are those two? We have to prove that they are symmetric and transitive. So symmetric and transitive is done in a different way. What is that? For reflexive, you have to check for each and every element belonging to the set. Any real number I take, let's say 1.5, then 1.5, 1.5 should belong to my relation. Getting it? So whatever element belongs to my set R, it has to come as an identical pair satisfying my relation. That is the condition for reflexive. But the moment I come to symmetric, I should check only if it is present in my relation. For example, I will give it to you that X, Y belongs to my relation. I will give it to you, it belongs to relation. So you're not going back to set and checking. That is not done in case of symmetric and transitive. So I will give you this information. Now, from this information, we know that X minus Y is an integer. So guys, Y minus X is an integer. Okay, so from this, we know that Y minus X is an integer. So based on this information, I have to prove that the reverse will also belong to the relation. That is what is meant by symmetric. So shall we try to do that? So guys, if x minus y is given to us, will it also be an integer? I know y minus x is an integer. So can I say x minus y will also be an integer? Of course, because I'm just negating it. Negation of an integer is also an integer, right? And hence, I can say from here, y comma x also belongs to my relation. So I started off with assuming x comma y being part of my relation. I wrote down the condition, and from that condition, I proved that y comma x can also be part of my relation. Therefore, if x comma y is present, y comma x will also be present. Hence, it is a symmetric relation. The next part is transitive. How do I prove transitive? Let's try to do that quickly and move forward. Okay. So how do you prove it is transitive? For transitive, you will take two particular relation presence. Okay. What is that? I will assume x comma y belonging to my relation, and I will assume y comma z also belonging to my relation. Now, given these two, I have to prove that x comma z will also be a part of my relation. If I can do that, it will be transitive. If not, nope. You can't comment on it. Okay. So let us get started. What do I have here? I have my x comma y belonging to relation, which means y minus z is an integer. Okay. And y comma z is also present. So z minus y is also an integer. Now from these two, if I just add it up, what do I get? I get z minus x is equal to integer plus integer, which will also be an integer. If this is proved, then I know that x comma z belongs to my relation. Therefore, it's a transitive relation also. Therefore, it is a transitive relation also. So we proved it is reflexive. We proved it is symmetric. We proved it is transitive as well. So all three together, what can we call it as? We can call it as equivalence relation. Okay. So statement one is absolutely right. So statement one is correct. So I know that this is wrong. Okay. Now let's check for statement two. Statement two, how do I do it? Just like what I did previously, to check for reflexive, I need to do x comma x for every real number. So let us say x comma x belongs to my set of real numbers. Real numbers. Okay. Set of real cross real. Of course it does. Now I should check whether it satisfies this. So let's say x is equal to alpha x. So alpha will be what? 1. So is 1 a rational number? Yes. So therefore, this will be reflexive. This will be reflexive. Whatever relation we have is a reflexive relation, because if x comma x is taken, it satisfies this condition such that alpha is turning out to be a rational number. So perfectly fine, it is reflexive. Now I will move forward and check whether it is symmetric or not. How do you check whether it is symmetric? Let me erase it down so that we'll have some space, because this is the important point in this question. So let us say x comma y belongs to R. I told you symmetric means you can take one to be belonging to the relation already. So I will take x comma y belonging to my relation. So what does it mean? It means x is equal to alpha y. Now, given x is equal to alpha y, does it imply that y will be equal to some alpha dash x such that alpha and alpha dash are rational? Is it necessary? Let's try to have a look in more detail. I know that alpha is rational because I have assumed x comma y belonging to my relation. Okay. So if I write y, I'll get 1 by alpha times x. From this relation, if I'm trying to move towards proving the reverse, I should do it like this. Now, is this 1 by alpha also rational? Not necessary, because alpha can be 0. If alpha is 0, what will be 1 by 0? It will be not defined. That is why it is not symmetric. Okay? So it is not necessary. If x comma y is present, it is not necessary for y comma x to be present. and therefore it is not a symmetric relation. If it is not symmetric, it cannot be equivalence. So statement 2 is false. So statement 2 is false, which means option B is correct. Okay, all of you fine with it, guys? So that is how you solve it. I hope you learned something useful from this question. If you have any doubts in the way I did it, please let me know. Okay, so here I wrote it as alpha dash, because if I can prove this and if I can prove alpha dash is rational, then I can say that y comma x also belongs to the relation. But unfortunately here it doesn't happen, because I disproved it by giving an example. So if alpha was 0, 1 by alpha is not defined. Therefore it contradicts. Hence it is not symmetric. If it is not symmetric, it cannot be equivalence. Okay, perfect, guys. So I'm sure all of you are able to follow. With that, let's move forward to the next question. I have given you the answers over here. You guys can go through it later on. And if you have any doubts or comments, do let me know in the chat. Okay, let's look at the next question that I have for all of you. So here we have a real x for which the function is defined as x cubed plus 5x plus 1. Then I want you guys to tell me whether this function is 1 to 1, on 2, or neither 1 to 1, on 2. Okay, you have to check whether it is 1 to 1 or on 2. So let's try to do that. Let's try to start off solving this question. It was asked in the year 2009. It is pretty simple, but the concept you learn is important. How do you figure out whether it is 1 to 1? How do you figure out whether it is on 2? All that we will be discussing in this question. Okay, so guys, whenever you want to prove 1 to 1, now always go with the idea of strictly increasing function. So if you have strictly increasing or decreasing function, it will be 1 to 1. Because let me give you an example, simple example. So let us say you have a graph like this. So this is a strictly increasing function, and don't you think it is 1 to 1? How do you figure out it's 1 to 1 when the graph is given? You try to draw any horizontal line. It will cut the curve only at one point. Then you can know that it is a 1 to 1 function. Clear, guys? So let us try to use this concept over here and solve this question. So here what will I do? I'll try to find out its derivative. So f dash of x, if it is greater than 0, it's a strictly increasing function. Strictly increasing function, okay? F dash of x, if it is greater than 0, it's a strictly increasing function. That is what I'm trying to prove over here. So let's try to find its derivative. What is its derivative? It is 3x square plus 5. And guys, we know that 3x square is always positive. And on top of that, I'm adding a positive number. And therefore, that will be always greater than 0. So I have proved that this is a strictly increasing function. So I know for sure it is 1 to 1. So this option is wrong and this option is wrong, because I know for sure it is 1 to 1. Now I have to check whether it is on 2. So the function is going from all real numbers to real numbers. So if I have to prove it is on 2, I need to show that my codomain will be equal to range. If I can show that my codomain is equal to range, my job here is done. So let's try to figure it out. What is my range here? I know my function is strictly increasing. So the lowermost value will be at the left-hand side extreme point, and the highest value will be at the right-hand side extreme point. What do I mean by that? Sir, I do not get what you're saying. So let us say you have an increasing function from A all the way up to B. Okay, so it's a strictly increasing function. Can you all see that? Because it's always going up as I move rightwards. So if I want to find out the range of this function, it'll be what? It'll be f of a to f of b. F of a is the lowest value and f of b is the highest value, given that this function is f of x. Why did I say that so confidently? Because guys, when you have a strictly increasing function, the lowest value will be at the leftmost point of the domain, and the highest value will be the rightmost point of the domain. As simple as that. So let's try to do that for this question as well. So here in this question, the domain is going to be R. So what is the leftmost point of domain? Minus infinity. What is the rightmost point of domain? plus infinity. So what is the functional value as my x approaches minus infinity? This term will dominate. So minus infinity whole cube will tend to minus infinity. And as my x approaches infinity, again this term will dominate and it will be equal to infinity. So the lower limit or the lower value of range is minus infinity and the highest value is plus infinity. So I cover all values from minus infinity to plus infinity. Therefore, my range is set of all real numbers. So my range is actually equal to codomain. Therefore, it is onto also. It is onto also. That is why option C is correct. I hope you guys have got it. If you have any doubts or confusion in the way I have solved it, do let me know in the comments, guys. And if you learned anything new, great. Please note it down and keep revising it. Shall we move forward? Yes. So let us go ahead to the next question and see what else we have in store. So this is option C. It is both one-to-one and onto. I have given you the written solutions. You guys can download the session PDF and have a go through it slowly. Okay. Let us move forward. Now, again a question from the previous years, IIT JEE 2003. And we are here to find out the range of this function. You are supposed to find out the range of this function. Guys, there are many ways to do it. Okay, there are multiple ways to do it. The standard method to solve this question is, take it as y. Y equal to x square plus x plus 2 divided by x square plus x plus 1. And then what will you do? You will cross multiply. You will get x square y plus xy plus y equal to x square plus x plus 2. Isn't it? And then what will you do? You will bring everything to one side. You will get x square into y minus 1 plus x into y minus 1 plus y minus 2 is equal to 0. And then you know that x belongs to real numbers. No? It's given to us. So you will make sure that the discriminant of this quadratic in x should be greater than or equal to 0. Because I can treat it as a quadratic in x. No? And when you do this inequality and solve it, you will get the answer. Because this inequality will contain y. I'm sure you guys must be aware of it. Please try it out and do it. But I'm not going to solve it by this method. I've given you the hint and I've given you the approach as well. Try to do it and match it with the correct answer. I will teach you another unique way of solving this question. Please listen carefully, guys. Okay. Let us try to solve it by a different method. So guys, can I write this f of x as x square plus x plus 1 plus 1 divided by x square plus x plus 1. Now what can I do over here? I can write it as 1 plus 1 by x square plus x plus 1. Are you all fine with that? Now what I'll do is I'll try to complete the square over here. So x square plus x plus 1 can be written as x plus 1 by 2 whole square plus 3 by 4. Don't you all agree with me on that? I complete the square in this fashion. Completion of square is something which you have learned in 10th standard, guys. Please be very well aware of it because it is used in integration heavily. Okay. So I completed the square and I'll put it over here. So 1 plus 1 by x plus 1 by 2 whole square plus 3 by 4. Now, if I want to find out the maximum value of this function, the maximum value of this function will occur when this denominator is minimum. When will this denominator be minimum? When this square term is lowest in value. Because this square term only is varying. Na? It only has x. So when this square term is minimum, then the entire value of f of x will be maximum. So when will square term be minimum? Square term will be minimum when x is equal to minus 1 by 2. And that belongs to domain. Na? So when x is equal to minus 1 by 2, this will be 0. So the answer will be 1 plus 4 by 3, which will be 7 by 3. And can you guys see that? 7 by 3 is the maximum value in C option. So directly I know that is the correct answer. Okay. And how will you find the minimum value? The minimum value will occur for f of x when this is maximum. When your denominator is maximum, then the f of x value will be minimum. When will denominator be maximum? When x tends to infinity. when x tends to infinity, this will almost tend to 0. If it almost tends to 0, then it will be 1. So that is why you see the minimum value is 1. Got it? So this is a nice way of solving it. It's much faster, saves you time. The second method is what I told you earlier. Try to solve it and compare the answer, guys. Okay? You will have to get the answer. Please do it as an exercise. Don't neglect it. It is just 2 minutes job. Do it and you will be happy with the way you did it. Okay? Perfect. So yeah, with that, let's move forward to the last question. The last question is the best one for the day. So this was asked in the year 2014 advance and it's a multiple choice question. So you have more than one option correct. You might be wondering, sir, why is that included in this series which is meant for mains? The reason is, guys, I wanted to explain multiple concepts. So this single question contains at least 3 to 4 concepts intermixed with each other. So let's try to break them down one by one. Okay. So let us get started. So this question, you have to find out whether the function is odd, even, one-to-one or onto. And the function domain is given, codomain is given, and the definition is also given. So guys, the easiest part of this question is proving whether it is odd or even. Okay. So let's try to start off from that. Whenever you want to do a question, start with the easy ones. You will feel good. So what is f of minus x? That's how you prove odd or even, right? So if f of minus x comes out to be equal to minus of f of x, it is odd function. And if f of minus x comes out to be equal to f of x, it's an even function. Okay? Are you guys fine with that? So now, what is f of minus x? It's nothing but log of secant of minus x. What is secant of minus x? It is in fourth quadrant. So secant of minus x will be secant x only. And tan of minus x will be minus tan x because tan is negative in the fourth quadrant. And then I have whole raised to the power 3 on the outside. Okay, please be very careful. The power 3 is on the outside. Because when I first read the question, I assumed it to be inside. Okay, so don't make such mistakes. It is possible in an exam setup, you'll be under a lot of pressure and you might read it wrong. So please be calm and read it carefully. Now, you guys must be aware of this relation, no? What is that? Secant square x minus tan square x is equal to 1. Are you all fine with that? Secant square x minus tan square x is equal to 1. So from this, I can say that my secant x minus tan x will be equal to 1 by secant x plus tan x. Because this is a square minus b square equal to 1. So I can factorize it as a minus b into a plus b equal to 1. So a minus b will be 1 by a plus b. That's what I wrote. Why did I do that? Because guys, as I said, odd and even function, you have to relate f of minus x to f of x. So f of x contains plus, na? So I want to change this. That's what I did. So I'll write it as log of 1 by secant x plus tan x whole raised to the power 3. Now, this log of 1 by secant x plus tan x, I can write it as minus log of secant x plus tan x. Okay? Whole raised to the power 3. Is that fine? Now, how did this step come? I wrote this as secant x plus tan x raised to the power minus 1 because it's reciprocal, right? So when I write it as secant x plus tan x power minus 1, that power minus 1 comes to the front because of log properties. Now when I cube it, minus cube will be minus only, and then I have log of secant x plus tan x whole cube. Isn't that correct? Now what is log of secant x plus tan x whole cube? It is nothing but f of x. So I have minus outside and I have f of x. So I proved f of minus x is equal to minus of f of x, which means it's an odd function, which means it's not an even function. Okay? Brilliant. So we are done with the first half of the question. So let me erase all of it. So we have proved it's an odd function. I hope you guys have understood it. If not, please do recheck it by coming back to the video. Okay. Let's move to the second part. The second part is proving it is one to one. And guys, just now we saw a question in which we proved one to one by showing that the function is strictly increasing. It can be strictly decreasing also to prove one to one, But luckily for us, that question, it was strictly increasing. Let's try to do the same here. Let's try to figure out whether it is strictly increasing or strictly decreasing, so that directly we can say it is 1:1. Okay, let's do that. So what is my f dash of x? My f dash of x is differentiation of this one. Differentiation of this one is not quite easy, guys. You have to use chain rule. How do I use chain rule? The outermost function is x into cube. Okay, I have x to the power 3. So it will become 3x square. So 3 into log of secant x plus tan x whole square. Now, inside log is there. So I have to differentiate log, which will be 1 by x. So it will be 1 by secant x plus tan x. And then I have to differentiate this thing, secant x plus tan x, which will be secant x tan x plus secant square x. Okay, so differentiation of this will be secant x tan x minus or plus secant square x. Okay, so now what I'll do is I will take secant x common from the factor over here. Okay, so log of secant x plus tan x whole square is there. Here I'll take secant x common. If I take secant x common, I'll have secant x plus tan x, and the same I have below also in the denominator, secant x plus tan x. So I can cancel out this and this. I hope you guys got it. So guys, I will quickly explain to you what I did. So the differentiation of denominator, I wrote it here because of chain rule. Differentiation of denominator is what? Secant x tan x plus secant square x. Secant x tan x plus secant square x. I took secant x common. So you will get secant x plus tan x, that will cancel with the denominator. And what you are left out is right over here. You have 3 times log of secant x plus tan x whole square into secant x. So this is a positive number. This is also positive. So can I say my f dash of x is positive? So can I say it's a strictly increasing function? Are you all able to understand that? Brilliant. So therefore, since it is strictly increasing, it has to be 1:1. That's it. Now, how do you prove onto? That I will leave it as a homework for all of you guys. Comment it down. I will probably include it in the beginning of the next video, or I will help you out in the chat. Okay, so that is a homework for you. The answer is option A, B and C. So I want you guys to show me how to prove that f of x is an onto function. That is the homework. You guys can try it out. I will help you through the chat or in the beginning of the next video. Okay, so that will be the conclusion of today's session. I hope you guys liked the questions and benefited from it. So yeah, with that, let's conclude our session, guys. We will meet in the next class on Saturday. So till then, take care, keep working hard. And if you guys like the session, if you benefited from it, do check out the crash course which is offered by Vedantu. So you have a great offer going on. So if you use the coupon code SJCC, you will have the price reduced to 8,000. So if you have time for it, check it out and do join us. We can meet in the class. Okay. So all the very best, guys. If you liked it, share, subscribe and comment. That keeps us motivated and it helps us to bring out the best of content for you. Okay. All the very best. Keep working hard. See you in the next one. Take care and bye-bye.